In the New Testament, there was no church that was more generous than the Macedonian church. In 2 Corinthians 8:1-5, Paul tells us how their joy overflowed in rich generosity. The encouraging thing for us about this joy was the circumstances it came from. Paul explains that they were in the midst of severe trials and extreme poverty, and it was in these times that God gave them this overflowing joy that resulted in generosity. Trials and suffering couldn't shake these believers because they didn't care about stuff. Their secret was not what belonged to them, but who they belonged to. And every one of us will also face trials and sufferings at some point in our lives. And just like the Macedonians, we must decide who or what we will trust in when they do arise. So let's look at three truths that the Macedonian believers teach us that will help us obtain the same joy and generosity they had in their extreme poverty. First, nothing can shake the joy of the generous. Paul's description of the Macedonian state of affairs should not be taken lightly. Severe tests of affliction and extreme poverty. These circumstances were more than minor setbacks, yet God gave them the joy to not only make it through, but to give generously in the process. Secondly, generosity flows from a heart of self-sacrifice, not self-preservation. The motivation of giving is not to give in order to get. Instead, just like the Macedonians, it begins with our surrender to God and flows from His joy as we trust in Him. And finally, biblical giving comes from grace, not the law. Tithe, or 10%, is the biblical starting point for giving. Jesus validated this in Matthew 23, but as the Macedonians showed us, their giving was a direct result of the joy they found in God's grace, not from an obligation to give. These verses model for us the response God is looking for when we look at our financial situation. Paul tells us that the Macedonians gave themselves first to the Lord. In the same way, we should approach our finances by first affirming or reaffirming our commitment to trust God's promises. And secondly, we are told the Macedonians gave. Their generosity was the proof of where their joy really came from. And in the same way, our giving echoes what our hearts are trusting in.
We just sang a song that said, step by step, oh God, you are my God, and I will ever praise you. Do you feel that way about the Lord? Do you feel about Him being your God, about Him being so good to you, and about His claiming you as His child? Is that something that causes you to want to praise Him, to worship Him? I will seek you in the morning because my relationship with you needs to be an all-day affair. And I will learn to walk in your ways, to be like you. God is generous. He's incredibly generous. And He gives to us all the time. And so we want to become like Him. So step by step, we need to allow Him to lead us, to guide us, and to teach us about giving and about how we might be involved in the work that He's called us to do. I will follow you, not just today, not just this year, not just... well, how about all a lifetime? I'll be yours, and I'll do what you want me to do. Joy is indeed that offspring of giving. There isn't anything like it. This last January, I went down to Bangladesh and spent some time there looking at what goes on in a different culture, the culture in which many of the people who are living around us come from. And while we were there, I met a young man who was working as the cook for our guest house where we were staying. Kevin and I really took to this young man. I understood later as we went to the classes that Larry was teaching that this young man wanted to be a pastor, that he was preparing himself for the Lord's work. As time went on, we began to understand, through Larry telling us about it, that this man's father had cancer. He had it in a very, very bad way, extensive way. In fact, the hospital said, we can do no more for him. He needs to go home. You need to take him back to the place where he lives and allow him to die there. Well, these people were incredibly poor people. But in the process of working and trying to overcome the cancer, they had ran up a bill of 40,000 taka. Now, that means nothing to you, but 40,000 taka to them is probably what we would consider to be $1 million. I mean, how are we going to pay off $1 million? Here we have a young man who is working as a cook at a guest house, not making a lot of money there, for sure. His brother isn't working at all. He's the eldest, and so he has to be the one who's saddled with all that bill. And so it was our opportunity, our privilege, because of the money that we had left over, which you gave for us to minister to the people down there in Bangladesh. It was our privilege to give the money that was required to pay off that bill. Let me tell you, it felt good. It felt good to be able to help somebody in such a significant way. I always thought that I wanted to be like that man on The Millionaire, you know, who went around to different people's homes, and he said, well, I have here a cashier's check. It's written out for $1 million, and this is for you. And just see what people think about that, and see the joy on their faces. I know that that's not lasting joy, and I know that those sort of kinds of things probably bring more trouble than they bring really good things, but to be the person who's involved in helping other people is a real joy. I also serve here in the town on a committee that is required to evaluate requests from people within the town for help with their bills, with their rent, with their mortgages, whatever. And so it is our responsibility to interview these people, to think through what it is that they need. And then there is a fund in which we are administrators of. And so it becomes our privilege then to listen to these needs and to listen compassionately. I know there are people that will take advantage of a situation and try to get things for nothing. But it is our privilege to listen to those who truly have a need. If they truly had a sickness that kept them out of work for a number of months, now they're behind and now they need some help to catch up again. What a wonderful feeling it is to be able to say, listen, we're going to take care of this bill and that bill for you, and we're praying that the Lord Jesus will enable you to get back onto your feet again. That is something that God does. It is something that He wants us to do as well. It is something that our church is involved in, and it brings us great joy. Mike Haynes is part of the deacon board here, and it is his responsibility to evaluate those kinds of requests that come to the church. You are not aware of those requests because, well, people really require privacy. Who wants to have other people know the kinds of things that they're dealing with that are kind of private? And so you are not aware, and we would love to tell you that, you know, three times a week we're helping people significantly, and they are being taken out of a situation that they cannot cope with and given a chance again. But that is what part of your money, which you give to the church, goes for. And we are so thrilled to be able to do that. Now, there are times, you know, when you get people who come in, you know that they're going from church to church to church. And we have a network of pastors that helps us to know that, because they tend to, we talk amongst each other. And have you heard about this person? Do you know them? Have you ever worked with them before? Do you think the need is real? So we have a process that we go through. But it is a privilege when we find somebody who truly has a legitimate need, and we are able to give toward that. God is like that too. Here He is, that He has loved us so much that He sent His Son to die. He saw the need that we had. Well, it wasn't a surprise to Him. That was all part of the plan. But it is our way of imaging Him when we give to others in order for them to be able to start over again and make a new life for themselves. So part of the giving thing is a wonderful joy. You don't sometimes, you know, when we do actually give you something special, well, you guys really step up. I mean, we had a real special need, and I won't tell you whose it was or what it was for, but we just said we have a large need, and there's a family that needs that kind of help, and it's a legitimate need. And all of a sudden, the money began to pour in from you guys because you trusted us that there was a legitimate need, and you began to say, I want to do something. That is imaging the Lord himself. You are like that, and I am so glad to be part of a family like this, because you do step up when the times are hard. What's most difficult, though, is those times which are just kind of like the regular, ordinary kinds of stuff, like paying the electric bill so that we have these lights on and things like that. We really don't get much excitement out of that, all right? Today, we paid our electric bill. Isn't that great? I don't see anybody smiling, because that's really nothing that really tells us that, yeah, I'm really glad to do that. But that's all part of the ministry that God has given to us to support the work that he is doing here in our community. It's not just about bills. It's about outreach as well. As we are looking for ways in which we might get the gospel out to people, these are our opportunities. And if we don't have materials to help with, if we don't have a place to invite them to, if we don't have people who are ready to work, well, then we can't do the things that we're wanting to do. We can't send people to Bangladesh. We can't send people to India. We can't send people to Papua New Guinea. And when we do, there are people that will rejoice in our generosity and the things that we give. Now, we don't always connect the money that we put into the plate with the actual going, because we're not always collecting just for a particular cause. But it is all part of the different budgets that we have, the missions budget, the benevolence budget, and the budget that's for paying your pastor and things like that. I get a lot of encouragement from the fact that I don't get half checks when I get paid. It's because people are faithful in giving, because they want and they see that there's a ministry to be had, that we can grow as a body of believers if there is teaching going on, and the caring for the sick and the caring for those who are dying and things like that. Those are things that we all can do, but there needs to be money that supports that kind of work. And so it is a privilege for us. It is a privilege for us to give toward that and see it happen, even though if we can't make the direct connections between the dollar we put in and the dollar that's spent on that particular need. The deep down most important motivation for giving, though, is because we want to be like God. We love him. He is the one who provides for us. We read Psalm 104, and we talked about, that psalm talked about how he cares for creation. He gives the animals the food that they need, the birds and the fishes and things like that. And he gives to us the opportunity to work and to plant and to receive food. He is continuously, always, regularly generous with us. If there's famine, if there are things that happen in which judgment comes upon us, it isn't because God has suddenly forgot about us. He has purposes in everything that he does, with rain and with sun and with storms and all of those things. But on the everyday kind of life, God is incredibly faithful, and we see it. And we want to be like him. Now, we understand that when we think about our families, we who are parents, we understand that we need to be regular in caring for the needs of our kids. We need to be putting away money for school. We need to be paying the bills for our utilities on a regular basis. We need to be buying food so that the kids can eat, and we need to have clothes for the children. We all understand that those things cost money. But those are things that we do willingly, happily, because we are looking towards the goal that will come from it. And that is what God does as well. He provides this world for us to live in so that we might seek after him and come into that relationship with him that fulfills us as people. It isn't just simply to keep people alive. It is so that he might have a relationship with them and love them, and they love him as well. And so he provides and provides and provides. We haven't had a single day in my lifetime where the sun didn't come up. There hasn't been a single day. And so we need to understand that God is regular. He's faithful. You can be dependent upon him. One of our most favorite songs is, "Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father." This is the truth, because he is there every single day for every single need that we have. We want to be like him. We want to love him. This is our way of worshiping him. The things that he gives us, to care for our families and to care for our needs, are things also that he has given us to supply for his work in the world. The prayer that Jesus told us to pray was, "Our Father who art in heaven." We are in existence with him as our Father. "Hallowed be thy name. God, I admire you. I love you. I worship you because how great you are and how deep is your love for us. Your kingdom come. Your will be done." It's about, because you're so great and because you're the King, because you're the Lord of all things, I want to surrender myself and trust you for the kingdom work that you are doing. You're King over creation, obviously. You're the one who controls all that goes on the face of the earth. But you're also controlling what goes on in that secret kingdom of the heart, the kingdom that Jesus referred to when he stood before Pilate. And Pilate says, "So you're a king, are you?" And Jesus told him that his kingdom was not of this world. Its people were in the world, but its source was not from the world, but from heaven. It was a kingdom of heaven that he is propagating throughout the world. And this kingdom, when we pray those words, "Your kingdom come, your will be done," is our commitment to him that his work should be accomplished. How wonderful it would be if all people worshiped God for who he is. Wouldn't it be so wonderful that people would not complain, that people would not fight over resources, but they would share them eagerly, gladly, because of the fact that God distributes his resources to all people as well. Wouldn't it be great if people would submit to his kingdom, that he would be king in their lives? So we commit ourselves then to seeing that happen. He has provided for that in our income as well. He hasn't given us just enough so that we might have the things that we have, but he has given us also plenty for the support of the kingdom, for the things God is doing in the kingdom. As God is regular and God is faithful, so should our support of that kingdom be. It is important that we have some sort of plan about our giving. A plan doesn't make it mechanical. A plan does not make it impersonal. A plan just simply makes it probable that it'll happen. If we just think about giving in terms of, when I get to church, I'll look in my wallet to see what I got, and then I'll put it in what I don't need for the rest of the day. That is not a plan. That is not considering the importance of the kingdom. Remember in that video slide that talked about his kingdom was to be first. Your kingdom come, your will be done. And then the next part of the prayer talks about, give us this day our daily bread. It isn't just simply that we might be able to sustain lives that are happy and do what we want. It is that we would sustain lives that serve him in that kingdom. It's all about the kingdom. And if it's that important, all encompassing in our lives, then we need to think about, how will I give to that kingdom? Now, God does not ask us to give more than what we have. He does not tell us to give what we cannot afford. But he does tell us to give according to what we have been given. And so we need to think about that. We need to go before him in prayer and say, "Lord, my desire is that you will be glorified in every aspect of my life, not just about the going to church thing, but about my support in the work of the kingdom. Lord, right now I don't have a plan. Right now I haven't really thought about it. But I want to do something that honors you. And if indeed this work is primary in the world, then I need to give it priority. It needs to be the first fruits of all of my increase. It needs to come off the top before anything else. And Lord, I'm not really sure how that could do that. I'm not sure how that will fit in. And so, Lord, I'm coming to you in prayer, and I'm asking for wisdom. My desire is to do your will. Now reveal your will to me, and I will do it. Step by step, I'll follow you, and I'll praise you in all my ways, all my life. This is indeed the source of joy in us, that we have a significant part in what God is doing in this world for all eternity. Not just to buy something that several weeks from now I'll be tired of, but it's something that will last forever and ever. We have that privilege. It belongs to us now. And I'm encouraging all of us to think through what we are doing and ask God to reveal to us what he wants us to do. And that may be that God will say to you, you know what? You're giving too much. You're giving way too much. You need to slow down here. Or it may be that he'll say, no, you're doing just what I want you to be doing. This is my will for you. But you have to understand, you need to be receptive and say, Lord, what is your plan for me? Reveal it to me. I'm willing. Even if it causes me to sacrifice. You sacrificed for me in sending your son. I want to sacrifice for you. Macedonian Christians were incredible, weren't they? To think about their poverty and their being persecuted, and yet they were joyed, full of joy to give. In fact, they begged Paul to have a part in the things that he was going to do to help the Christians in Jerusalem. Jerusalem, so far away. Yes. For them, it was so important to be involved in it. They're an example that Paul gives to us. And if Paul gives it to us, then God has given it to us too. Let us be wanting, Lord, help us to participate in the way in which you want us to. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you that you hear us. I thank you, Lord, that it is a privilege for us to give. Every one of us, pastor all the way down, all the way through, every single person, child as well as adults. Help us to give, not only of the things that we own, not just money, but of our talents and of our time, of our work, our efforts. Lord, I do thank you that this is a church that does give. And I thank you, Lord, that they give of their time and they give of their efforts and they work hard. And I'm proud to be part of this family. But every once in a while, Lord, we need to evaluate where we are and what we're doing. And so, Lord, I pray that you would just open our hearts to you and allow you to speak to us. And we give you thanks and praise for that. In the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen.